These are those moments in history when your heart is so full because you know the source of your inspiration and strength. Mother Mandela, we, your children at Jerusalem, who have been imbued with your spirit, not only to strive, but to achieve it. Your presence here is not accidental. Your strength is not of man. Your vision is not a political vision. So you had to come up to Jerusalem, the village of peace, at a time of war. Because here at the village of peace, the world would know that the problems of Jerusalem need another mind and another spirit. What would be more appropriate than for you to convene at Jerusalem in the village of peace the beginning of discussions on how to resolve the problems affecting the people? Now, what are your credentials? You were tried in the crucible of hate to see if in fact you would hate. You were the voice for the voiceless, and you were threatened with destruction if you continued to speak. You were the mother to the motherless. When the world wanted to make South African orphans in the world. But you needed help. You didn't need the weapons of this world. You needed the power of the living God. And so that wise knowing God of Africa told his son, Ben-Ami, it was time to get back to Jerusalem. The vision came in 1966 to see if African people could reconnect spiritually with this land. And like you, he was obedient to those words that said it was time to return back to the promised land. Israel is a land of 102 nationalities. More than 83 languages are spoken here. South Africa, a land of contradictions, produced a woman, a spirit, a leader. So it's appropriate that you meet with the leadership of the Palestinians, the Israelis, and let them speak to you as you process for them ways in which to resolve the most difficult issues. Because here at Dimona, the village of peace, we have convened the minds and the spirits to give you that strength. And so I want to thank Ben-Ami for sending me to South Africa to speak to you. And I want to thank you for receiving his invitation to come here. Because the world must know that South Africa has much to give Israel. And that Dimona has much to give South Africa. And that this connection of the strength and the spirit, those who struggle against hate, and those of us who've come out of the Americas after more than 400 years have been scattered from this land, it's only appropriate that you be here. You see, if South Africa is known for its diamonds, and the Queen of England has those precious stones there, and they cherish that as valuable, and it took millions of years to turn that piece of carbon to that clear diamond. How much more the diamond that have been made and fashioned, that have produced you in the crucible of challenge? You are the real diamond of South Africa. You are the real rock of South Africa. So we want you, on behalf of the anointed spiritual leader, say to you, welcome home. Welcome home. Welcome home. How long would you
waste any time? I asked the question, who are the real children of Israel? And I'd like to answer it right away.
Go ahead, you understand.
Like any good lawyer in a courtroom, he tells you what he's going to prove.
All right.
And then he goes ahead and proves it and let the jury make the decision. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has said that Almighty God Allah revealed to him that the black people of America are the real children of Israel. And we are the choice of God. And that unto us he will deliver his promise.
First and foremost, giving all honor and praise to the Creator of the heavens and the earth, we thank that great God for his grace, for his mercy, for his benevolence. We thank him for our founding fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We thank him for Moses and the Torah. We thank him for Yeshua and the gospel that he brought forth, the Injil. And we thank him for Prophet Muhammad Ibn Abdullah for the Holy Quran. Peace be upon those noble and worthy servants of God. But surely, if I can thank that great God of men, women, I know only from scripture, only from study, I must surely thank him for those who he has sent in this dispensation of time. And I could go on forever and ever thanking Almighty God for those who he has sent to be a witness bearer of his truth. But I must certainly take the time to thank those who has personally helped form, shape, mold me into the man I pray one day to be. So I'm eternally grateful for the most honorable Elijah Muhammad, the God that he represents, Master Farad Muhammad. I thank him for his students, the honorable brother Minister Louis Farrakhan, and those in the Nation of Islam under his leadership and guidance. I thank him for Munir Muhammad. May Almighty God be pleased with his life and his service. the co-founders of Brother Shaheed Muslim and Khalif Muhammad, and all of those who are striving for righteousness. I am grateful again for God showing his favor once more by sending his angel, the angel Gabriel, in 1966 to visit His Excellency Ben Ami HaMashiach and to impart to him a vision to return back to the land of our fathers, to establish land, language, and culture again in the Holy Land. So I'm eternally grateful for him to have the fortitude to hear the angel, to follow the vision, and to fulfill it. I am grateful for Nasik Shaliach, that master teacher, formerly known as Prophet L.A. Bryant, who was able to hear Ben Ami and be able to move on that prophetic utterance of returning back to land, language, and culture, and to be able to edify us with the strength spiritually and prophetically of the knowledge of self. And if those two were to have a spiritual child, it would most certainly be the man that I pray one day to follow in the footsteps of. My father, my teacher, my example, Prince Asiel, the Holy Redeeming Angel, Shagrir, in those holy and righteous names, I greet you again, my brothers and sisters, in the words of peace. Shalom Aleichem, Assalamu Aleichem, peace be unto you. Again, brothers and sisters, it is, for me, such a privilege, such a pleasure, such an honor to be before you and to have the opportunity to be a part of a lineage, to be a part of a legacy that is fulfilling prophecy right before our very eyes, to be in position to have been taught, led, guided by such influential, positive, strong, intelligent, fearless men and women. But most certainly, not to omit the reality of my participation. Because just though I was privileged enough, just because I was blessed with so many opportunities to be in the company of such esteemed men and women of God, that does not mean that by osmosis that I would continue in that lineage, in that legacy, in those prophetic footsteps. So I had to choose this reality as well. But brothers and sisters, when you are so close to greatness, when you're able to touch and kiss the reality of the fulfillment of God's word, you cannot, and I mean sincerely, you cannot in good conscience turn away and do something else. Even if you try, every moment, every step that you make will be tormented. You will be in perpetual pain and anguish. And so, though all of those things have been, to a later or lesser or greater extent, placed before me to succeed, the choice, as the scripture tells us, is still ours at the end of the day. Life or death. Freedom or perpetual servitude, justice or inequality, which one will you choose? Fairness, or again, as we said, injustice. And so I am grateful that I have the privilege again to be in such a magnificent number. I started off with Prince Asiel Ben Israel, the Holy Ambassador, my father, and an opening that he so beautifully articulated when he was bringing on Mother Winnie Mandela, when she had arrived to the Holy Land, the Mona Israel, in representation of all of the freedom fighters. She embodied the spirit of all of those who wanted to get the yoke of their oppressor off of their neck. All of those African nations on the continent and all of those that were in the diaspora. She was a perfect representation of that. But it shows you how beautiful prophecy is. It shows you how beautiful the oneness of God is, because though she was one of the greatest, not just women, but freedom fighters in modern time, she, in such humility. And I did not play that part, maybe at another day, came before the world and professed that she was standing in the Mecca of Africa. She was standing in the geographical location of Israel, but most importantly, she was standing in the spiritual resurgence and rebirth of God's chosen people. And she, without fear or favor, articulated that this would be the vanguard for all of Africa. A place that up until 1969, there was no real authentic representation of our people in that land. Up until that point of 1969, there was, in particular in the diaspora, no real affiliation with our presence in that land. Yeah, we seen ourselves as a spiritual people. We seen ourselves as the people of the book here and there. But as far as making it manifest, making it tangible, and reconnecting ourselves back to that region, and then reorienting the thinking of not just those who inhabit that land, but of the planet, that you don't have to be frightened. You don't have to be fearful to know that the chosen of God, not the damned of God, are the original people of color. Are you and I? And so, listening to my father's words, I always get choked up, not just because that's my father, just not due to his oratorical skills, not because he has the ability to disseminate and articulate his point and position in such a profound way, but the work that was inculcated in the words to bear witness to everything that he said to be true. See, you cannot be a student of our people, contextualize yourself in the last 6,000, 2,000 years, or even 400 plus years, and not be emotionally drawn in to those words, but most importantly, what those words represented for the whole of humanity. You cannot, in good conscience, hear what was being articulated, see what was taking place, hear the worlds of our people coming together, though there were cultural differences as far as outward expression, inwardly, the desire for freedom, justice, and equality, the desire to have a place that would practice freedom, that we would be rid of the evils of this world, and we could live as one and not be emotionally pulled in. See, and I'm getting into my message, but I wanted to say this, that when you study freedom, when you study revolution, when you study the precepts of revolution and the things and the elements that produce a revolutionary movement, not just for those of us who study our people in antiquity, not just those who study the revolutionary uprisings in the diaspora or celebrate those who were able to overthrow their colonial oppressors on the continent. Even if you study European revolution, whether it be the French Revolution, American Revolution, the Russian Revolution in turning over, the Chinese Revolution, when you study the spirit of change, you're able to see what is taking place. And why is that important? Because this year, more than ever, is the fulfillment of that spirit of change. I played my father those words that seemed to be the past, but are very so much the present. Because to understand the times that we're in now, to understand the necessary building blocks that must be put in strategically so that we are able to construct and fortify a very stable structure, you have to do it appropriately. That means you have to put the right bricks in the right place to build the right thing. So as we do that, we have to understand those bricks that were put in place, those things that were laid before us, so that we have a comprehensive knowledge of what's taking place, so teaches the Holy Quran. we got to realize that that's why this educational process, and I've been saying this, and I'm going to keep saying it, and I'm going to keep saying it, and I'm going to keep saying it. When you understand the knowledge that we consume, the information that we intake into our lives, you understand that either it is going to develop a mind that is forming of a freedom fighter, or that one who practiced freedom, or is going to develop the mind of one who is going to practice slavery. Remember, in colonial society, education serves the colonialists in a society that's built on slavery. The education of the slave does not serve the slave, it serves the enslaver. So the educational institution was one that was formed to develop the slave and to develop the psychosis that would allow that slave to practice that slavery unknowingly to a certain extent, or to feel comfortable and complacent in that slavery. Today, I'm talking about the debt of paying, or the debt that must be paid for carrying the burden of our oppressor. The acceptance of being a slave is likened unto being a machine. The acceptance of being a slave is likened unto being a machine. We have been contextualized through science fiction, through a lot of the movies that we see, that the aim of the European is to make artificial intelligence the most realistic it possibly can, to make it human to a certain extent. But that has been actually incorrect. The aim, the purpose, the objective of the European, of the Euro-Gentile, has never been to make machines humans. It's to make humans, or the original man, machines. The contextualization of taking your God, taking your land, your language, your culture, your mores, your four ways, taking the very essence of who you are, that dehumanizes you, is so taught by Ben Ami. The dehumanization process is the stripping of the essence of the person. And it's not what you logically think. It's not what you articulate. It's not what you wear, so to speak, to a certain extent. It is the very nature of who you are and what you strive to do each and every day. And so, the very nature of you and I is the attaining of freedom. That's why even the scripture bears witness to that. History bears witness to that. That whenever you have nature bears witness to whenever you have any living organism that is entrapped, that his only aim, his only objective is to go for freedom, to find its freedom. You corner a mouse, it'll run here and there. But if you got, and it feels it has no way out, what is it? It attacks. It springs forward because it would risk its very life rather than give up its life to subjugation. Naturally. But if you're able to take away the essence or the desire of freedom, if you're able to remove your cultural understanding, your historical background, your roots, so to speak, you have no form of recollection that allows you to contextualize your current state. So everything is in the moment. So what do people say, especially our demographic and generation in this day and time? You only live once. I'm living in the moment. I only care about the right now. That's a people who have been stripped of the knowledge of self. That's a people who have no connection to their history, therefore cannot develop nor create a future for themselves, and most importantly, for their progeny. So the reality has always been to make you a robot. Now, we see it taking place in so many instances. The educational process, please do not think that I am denigrating or disrespecting anybody who has obtained any paperwork from the institutions here in America or the Western world. School and education is far greater than the confines of four walls, a university, a college, a school. Your educational process is the very essence of life. Every interaction that you have develops your mind, develops perceptions, develops understanding, the way you identify things. You learn farther before you reach any schooling or room that is contextualized under the more colloquial ways of learning in this Western thought environment. You're learning in the womb. The child is forming its thought processes in the womb, is learning how to deal even at a minute level with the digesting process of the mother, what is good for their system and what's not. This is all your body's learning at a chemical level, at a molecular level. It's learning how to deal with its environment. Look at the current situation with COVID-19. They said one of the things that we're waiting on is herd immunity, meaning that enough people will come in contact with the supposed disease or virus that it would develop a certain immunity, that it would be resisted by the sheer numbers of people who've contracted it, that it won't be as devastating. Two things there. Immunity is good to a certain extent, but herd immunity also from a spiritual and intellectual and cultural perspective is contagious and infectious. So if you become immune to something, you become desensitized to something. So we also know that certain immunization shots, certain vaccines, which are supposed to give you the ability to fight viruses, it also can help fight or destroy or decay the necessary good bacteria that is needed to survive. So once you become desensitized in this world, meaning once you start to accept the realities of your current circumstance, you'll start to lose what makes you or gives you value as an independent free thinker. Walk with me now. Walk with me now. I want you to walk with me now. This is important to where I'm going in this message and where we're going to be leading up after this. Because we are in a time, again, where we cannot go back on our heels. We're in a time, again, that we have a brief opportunity window that we can create or continue to recreate a reality that is representative of the true nature of a people, which is freedom, justice, and equality. Now, if you tell me that you have freedom, justice, and equality in this current state, I am not talking to you. If you're telling me that that is a reality that you agree that is real and viable in your life, that you have those things, don't listen to this or anybody. Your life is perfect. I am talking to that group of people who see injustice, who see inequality, who see all of those malcultural and societal things that does not allow us to be a free people. I'm talking to you. Because unfortunately, we keep operating under the presupposition that somebody else will implement and create that reality for us. Somebody will produce a free and just and equitable world for us. Well, let me tell you this. This is the other part of this class, and this is why this is so important. Because guess what? The people that you're looking to give you a better world didn't create this world. You did. You are responsible for this current world. No, you're not the one that's making the decisions. Of course not. No, you're not the one who has put everything in place, but every successful attribute about the Western world, whether it be America, whether it be Britain, whether it be France, it was on the backs of the blacks. You came up with all the great inventions. You came up with all of the necessary things that allowed this society to progress, to become a world power. You created the cell phone. You created the refrigerated car. You created the toilet. You created the light. You, everything of consequence that we use today, you created. Now, he weaponized it and used it against you, but you created it. So it goes into the message today that we have been a surrogate for white power. What is a surrogate? Let's look for a second. Now, a surrogate mother, a woman who bears a child on behalf of an infertile woman. When you have a surrogate mother, it is usually due to the nature that you are not able to bear a child yourself, or you just don't have the desire to do so. So you have somebody else bear that child for you, but once that child has been given birth to, the person takes the responsibility, the blessings, and the privileges of having that child. Though you did the carrying, though you did the work, you did the pushing, the connection is to you on a biochemical sense. They reap the benefits. Why am I saying that? America, you birthed America. You've birthed the Western world. There is no European nation that is seen to be a world power that did not do that without your direct help and assistance. We'll use America for right now because that's where I'm at, and form that contextualization real quick. The American Revolution was started with the mind of a black man, Christopher Atticus, who gave them the blueprint and the plan for the Boston, would end up be the Boston Tea Party. That turned into the Boston Massacre. And he was the first one killed. The first blood that was shed in the Revolutionary War was you. They got to this land with the direction of the Moors who were in Spain at the time. At the end of 1492. You directed them to this land. They were looking for you. Washington, D.C., their capital, their farmer's almanac, the way that they perceive time. Benjamin Banneker, another black man. Think about George Washington Carver, the one who created all of these different products from a peanut. I mean, we can go on and on and on and on. Thomas Edison took credit for the light bulb. That was a black man. You have been the surrogate for white power. You've continued to use your mind, your ingenuity, your creativity to produce all of the benefits for this country and for this world, yet you don't reap the benefit of none of it. So I can understand why, for a lot of us, there's an emotional connection, because you've been carrying this baby. You gave birth to this baby. I understand why you don't want to leave it, but this baby has been under the mind, under the direction of the oppressor, of the devil. So that child, though it has your DNA, it has the mind of the very person that has brought on all the hell and death and damnation. So I'm saying that to say that it is time to give up that surrogacy and to be a mother, to be a parent, a parental to our own nation. We have to again put all of this energy, all of this time into birthing our own reality. Otherwise, what is the benefit of doing what we're doing? Why get education? Why get schooling? Why acquire wealth? Why continue to produce families and get married? What are you doing this for if you're going to produce, or you're going to just produce children to put them in the same insidious and harmful world that was already in existence, that you have already identified has been unjust and unequal and unfair. Every day you're in the streets rioting. Every day you're in the streets protesting. Every day you're talking about how somebody's doing you wrong. All this energy to vote Trump out. All this energy to try to get justice for our people who are being murdered and killed every single day. That energy can be used, can be funneled, can be channeled into the creation of your own world. I played the Shy Greer earlier. I played Damona because that was a glimmer of hope and reality for us as a people if we get serious about producing our own world. That nations who had a longer existence than us from a national perspective had to come and bear witness and say, you are more advanced than we are. That was what Winnie Mandela was saying, Mother Winnie Mandela was saying, by saying that we're the Mecca, that we're the spiritual hub for all of Africa, that you would be the example for all of us. She said, because what you have done in a matter of 40 years, I believe it was 37 at the time, had superseded hundreds of years that we've been under this oppressor's yoke, that his foot has been on our neck. Because at the outset, there were no disillusions about our reality of wanting to integrate and amalgamate into Israeli society. The original precept is that we're coming to be a nation unto ourselves. Damn the torpedo. Straight ahead. We don't care what anybody says, does, or bring. We're willing to take on all that comes with that. So we're at a point where we can't lose our way now. Because again, if this year hasn't shown us anything, is that there is no way around this great wall of lies and deception, of disconnected truth. The only way is through. Remember, we've been turned into machines. How do you do this? You do this by removing the idiosyncratic nature of a person. That means the small details that make a person unique. So when you remove the idiosyncratic nature of a person, you make them predictable. And if you make somebody predictable, that means you are able to determine their outcome. And it's easily possible to disconnect them from light and truth because you know what they're already going to do. Why haven't none of our moves or groups or organizations or movements been successful? I mean, really successful in a long term outside of one or two. And even then, it's had hiccups. It's because we have been predictable. They know what we're going to do. You know what we're going to do. When we're able to go through with the Freedom Act, the old FBI COINTELPRO files in regards to the Nation of Islam, they said, we're not going to be able to do nothing with Elijah Muhammad. He's too powerful. We'll wait till he dies and or is killed. He said, and then we would use his children to dismantle the very nation that he built. Tie up all the properties in probate court and be able to deteriorate the nation from within. Is that not what happened? Did Water Deem, may God be pleased with his life, take the Nation of Islam in a total direction that was opposite or in opposition of what his father had built? If he wanted to do that, he could have just did his own thing. He didn't have to say that, hey, I'm going to represent my father and sit in his seat and continue his work. And then a year later, everything has been turned on his head. And this is not a knock to that brother, but I'm saying how we must learn from history. How we must be very circumspect about the conditioning and the training and the information and the knowledge and the visuals that we take in on a daily basis, because it is subtly contextualizing us to the point that we are dehumanized, meaning that we don't even have the ability to fight and protect our own freedom. Look at the nature of our men today. There is no continuous and unified example of us protecting and elevating our women and children. Think about the disconnect of the family. Think about the fractionalization of the man and woman and of the children. Think about that. How many young girls that you can see their father as a hero, and he actually be a hero to them? Not just the innate love that a daughter has for a father, but he's actually in her life guiding her and directing her, and she's able to have love and compassion for her. Even our beloved sister, Beyonce, who had a great father who taught and put her in the world of prominence here in America as far as an entertainer, at the end she disavowed him. Same thing with Serena and Venus Williams, and look at that now. What is the continuation? When are we going to break the cycle? When do we see on a continuous basis that the young men don't just have their father in their life, but they look up to their father and they say, I want to be just like them, just like him, because of his exampleship, because of what he has shown and taught me, what he has given me, the world that he has created for me, that I'm eternally grateful, so much so that I want to continue in his legacy. When do we see that on a continuous basis? We hear rap songs talk about how much we love mama, but there's very few songs about how much we love daddy from our young black men. When do we see our women say, I'm going to have a child with this man, not because I want to be secure, not because he's financially stable, not because his looks and charm, because he's such a great man, because he's so much strength and power in him, I want to produce more versions of him. Do you hear that conversation happen? Because the only way a woman should lay with a man is because she thinks the world needs more versions of him. Why else? And she knows she has something that can add to the value of him, therefore producing an even greater version of him, but using him as the model and the example. If you're watching, I need to know you're watching. Let me see some comments. Let me see something. Talk to me now. We don't need those silent watches. Let me know you're in the room. Let me know you're in the building, because it's going to be us that's going to change this. I said it before and I'll say it again. I don't do nothing else but this. This is my life. This is my work. You see my father. I can't do nothing else, even if I thought I wanted to. And trust me, I'm good at a lot of things. But this is the most important thing a man can do, and that's build a world and educate and be the example of the education that he represents for his people, most importantly, for his family. And if you don't see value in that, because I just talked about how a young man or any man should idolize his father, you don't see me represent that in my life? Shalom, shalom, Isha. Thank you. Somebody's there. You don't see me exemplifying that in my life? Not just about how I articulate and uplift my father, but look at how I live my life. You don't see me bringing no disgrace to him or my mother, because I value his worth and his work and his dedication and his sacrifice so much that I want to prove to him that not one second was in vain. But I understand the reality that we're in, because madness is infectious. There's a sister, Harriet Washington. I got her book, A Medical Apartheid. She has another book where she talks about the infectious nature of mental illness. And she discussed in this book that you can catch a mental illness like autism, OCD, schizophrenia, in the same manner that you can catch the flu, the cold, or any other viruses or bacteria or prions that you would catch that would cause flu-like symptoms. So, yes, there's nothing new. We know that germ warfare is real. We know that the chemical and biological warfare that produces a mentality that disconnects your cognitive processes, that you're not able to see and discern in any real intelligent way. But it goes even further, and this is where I come in at. The infectious nature of mental illness by being surrounded by other people who have mental illness. Now, what are you saying? Then we say, we keep talking about, especially in this day and time, that depression is so high. That insecurity is so high. That the introvert nature, not in the fact that it's someone who just don't like talking much, but introvert that they feel that they're incompetent and they don't fit or belong around other people. What do you think that comes from? That comes from being in groups of people who operate in that mentality. Because if you're around a certain behavior, you're going to succumb to it one way or another. And mental illness isn't those who just may cut themselves or inflict physical pain or need to be in a mental asylum. Mental illness is produced in so many various ways. A person who does not see the value in human life and takes it, that's a mental illness. A person who, in this day and time, with all the information and knowledge, who's still eating flesh, but in particular pork, swine, and those type of things, that's a mental illness. A person who thinks that it is okay to walk around 150 pounds overweight and say, accept me for who I am. Sure, we're not talking about the physical look, but think about the health ramifications that it has on you, that you're not able to live your life and be productive in no real serious way. That's a mental illness. See, we keep equating being in shape to superficialities because the screen on the television in the Western world has displayed it as such. But when you go back to the continent, you see our people in antiquity, they were never out of shape. Why? Because they lived active lifestyles. Their life depended on it. See, we have come into the realization because we've become machines that we don't need our physical health to be productive. Shalom, shalom, my beloved sister. Maria. What am I saying? I'm saying that we, in so many cases, are mentally ill. And to be mentally ill and to disregard that means that you are becoming inhuman. You becoming machine-like. Because the first thing when we get an illness, it should be to correct it. Man, I feel a cold coming on. Pumping your body with vitamin C. Staying hydrated. Maybe getting some rest. Dressing more appropriately. You do that because, hey, you don't want to miss work or you want to go out or whatever the case may be. So let's do this in every other way now. We're saying, well, this online schooling here, I know it's probably all over the world here in America, we're saying this online schooling is just not working. It's a disconnect between the children. They're not able to focus. It's disorganized. The system is always dropping. A mental illness would say, let continue on and try to see if it works out. But somebody who is sound of mind says, hey, my responsibility is to teach my children. My responsibility is to educate them and to dedicate them and to give them the necessary knowledge and infuse them with truth that is needed for them to be successful. Especially since we already said that this educational system isn't worth nothing. Especially in the inner cities, in the public school, when we know they're getting an inferior form of information or distorted form of information where their black selves has been written out of history. And when they do bring you up, they bring you up as a slave or somebody who's been killed by a white man for trying to stand up. That's the best of what they display to us. Hell, they even killed Black Panther. You hear what I'm saying? You can't have no heroes that look like you. You can't have no examples of greatness that look like you. That's what you've been conditioned as. And then think you know something because you went to a European school to study Black history. How does that work? Or you went to a historically Black school that's named after white supremacists. How does that work? So, not to go on a tirade. Vaccinations. Antibiotics are still in this world used to spread the viruses. Not just on a physical level, but on a mental and spiritual. So, what's the supposedly presented here in America? What's the cure to poverty for black people? What's the cure to a lower society position? Is education, right? That's the antibiotic. That's the vaccination that's given to us. Or a well-paying job, right? Or get a basketball and make it as an athlete. Or football, make it as an athlete. Have we seen that really institute any really real change? Have we seen that bring or heal ourselves in any viable way? I heard our brother say that, hey, and I believe I seen online the quarterback for the Kansas City Chiefs. I don't watch football no more. I can't recall his name, but he's a real famous guy. Everybody like him. It'll come to me maybe later. But he said, hey, athletes, you have a responsibility. You have a voice. Use that voice responsibly. But don't forget what gave you that voice, and that's football. So don't do it. And don't bring down football, the league, to use your voice. Use it responsibly. Meaning that, hey, yeah, you can speak up, but speak up with these pre-written, pre-accepted terms and phrases that we feel that are not really confrontational or don't really provoke any real change. No, football didn't what give you a voice. Your oppression, your 500 years of subjugation gave you a voice, whether you have a football in your hand or not. Every black man and woman has the right to speak up against the injustice. Any people who've been mistreated have the ability not just to speak up against the injustice, but to do something to remove those justices into perpetuity. But a mental illness says that you got to compromise one for the other. Again, the only antecedent is for you to give up your surrogacy and to be a producer of your own nation, your own world. Because again, there is no such thing as a great white civilization without the creation and the participation of black people, of you and I, of the original man. So the title of this class was that the black man certainly has to pay the debt for carrying the white man's burden. And what's the white man's burden? Is a term that was coined and phrased in the 1800s. It's the task that the white colonials believed that they had to impose their civilization on the black inhabitants of their colonies. And this is much more so than other European or Euro-Asian colonies that they had, because Britain conquered East India, which was you and I for the most part, but they still have some similitudes of their culture. China, Indochina, Britain conquered that. America, but they still have similitudes of their culture. But when you were conquered, when you were colonialized, your history, your identity was totally decimated. You know how much work had to take place for us to even get to this position of understanding? And that's why I tell even the best of our historians, our anthropologists, our archaeologists, that we got to do so intelligently. We look in the past and we are able to form certain ideas, but so much was lost, so much was destroyed. Not just from a historical perspective, but the internal relationship to our God, to one another, and to our environment, that it has to be rebuilt. So we use that for inspiration, we use that for guidance and for reference, but the world that we need to have, we can't look to the past for. We have to build it now. Because we wouldn't be in this position if they did everything properly and right. You gotta hear me now. Oh, whoa, I know. Oh, he's Moses, oh, Abraham, whoever you want to.
They didn't do everything right. Because if they did, we would not be in this position. It wouldn't correlate. So obviously, missteps had taken place. Obviously, mistakes and problems had arose to create a disconnect. So again, we look back for reference, but the reality of the future must be created and perpetuated now. We have to give birth because we use history as a form of escapism to elude the responsibility and the accountability of today. You gotta create your world, brothers and sisters. Nobody else is tasked with that duty or responsibility. Now, we have to reverse the reality of manifest destiny. It's another term that came in the 1800s here in North America, where it was defined that white America was destined by God to expand its dominion and its domination. Manifest destiny. And they're able to authoritatively prove that that may be true due to the nature of their dominance. That's how they can substantiate their claims. Our God, well, their God obviously gave them some type of power for them to dominate and control at your toil, at your suffering, at your hardship. But now, how do we take the white man burdens off us? Because we have been not just the one who carried the debt of the white man's burden, but we've been the one who have perpetuated everything that Black America in particular has been deemed to make successful has not pushed us further as a people. It's pushed certain individuals further financially and socially, but it has put white America in a whole nother stratosphere. Black rap, R&B, black music is one of the most influential forms of entertainment in the whole world. Black America don't benefit from black music. When we did, it was destroyed, and we benefited somewhat economically, but it was more on a social level because remember, rap was used as a form of protest. It was used as a form of education. It was used as a form to disseminate information and to fight the systematic oppressive state of white supremacy. It was morphed into a more raunchy and vulgar state. And then guess what? We still participate in it. We are the faces of it, but white America benefits from it. That's everything now. I'm using that as an example because that's the most relatable, but that's everything. That's everything. Even with, in 2020, the supposed Black Lives Matter, which is supposed to be representation of you, that pushes white America, LGBTQ, and everything else further, but keeps you in the back. It's not they benefit from it. So yeah, they'll kneel down at a football game or do because it don't mean nothing because they know they're able to keep you in place. They're able to pacify their black moneymakers from sitting down or sitting out because they understand that you are the reality of their leagues, their entertainment systems, and they're able to keep on going while you still are at the tail. Take your mind back. Become a human again and put your freedom and yourself before anybody else. You can't help no other people unless you help your own people first. You can't help yourself as an individual. You can't help anybody else unless you help yourself as an individual first. Same thing I said a couple classes back. The airline had it perfectly put. When the oxygen mask drops, if the plane is in descension, it is possible it may crash. Put yours on first before attending to children, infants, or even elderly. Because you're not going to be able to put their mask on if you're suffocating yourself. And since you are the most able and the most strong, you can more quickly put yours on and then put theirs on. rather than them not having the ability or not being able to do it in no timely fashion. So what am I saying? I'm saying I had to put my mask on since I knew I was the most able. And my family, my brothers and sisters. But now I'm trying to help put your mask on as well. Not for self-gratification, but so that we can all live. Because there is no such thing as survival with one person. That's not why the world was created. It was the interaction and the harmonious nature of your environment, of your ecology. I mean, people and people and environment and earth. And so as we reboot and restart and reset our spiritual circadian rhythm, we have to do so with the idea of knowing that the only route, the only option, the only course of action is to build our own world. That's why I started off with that video at the beginning and I let it go for about 4 or 5 minutes. It's because we have to be comfortable building our own world. And I know some of us feel we participated in these different movements and we seen some things that was atrocious. We seen things that were insidious and disgusting. We experienced them, and it's a lot of hurt and it's a lot of pain. But you got to realize that we're talking about generational pain. Though our parents and grandparents were attempting to do a great thing, they were trying to remove a lot of the unsavory and ill behavior that they had succumbed to for hundreds of years. It's not going to be done in one generation. See, we can't think as children no more and chastise and punish those who were doing the best with what they had. But if we feel that we were able to identify their inhibitions, their inabilities, their mistakes, their shortcomings, then we should be able to do it in ourselves and fix and rectify those so we don't show another generation that ill behavior. Are you up for that challenge? Are you up for that responsibility to work on self to such an extent that you are able to consciously remove everything in your heart that you know is bad? And be open and willing to listen to those who may be a little bit more advanced to you to get the constructive criticism to go even further than past the things that you can't see for yourself? Are we going to be gods or are we going to continue to be slaves? Are we going to be humans again or are we going to be machines? The choice is yours. I'm going to close there. Because I will be back Sunday. Oh, I'm sorry. I will be back Sunday tomorrow. I'm hosting for those. Crow. Hosting the show tomorrow. Thank you to my brother Jamil Muhammad. At 2:30. On YouTube, Facebook. And Streamlabs. The Munir Muhammad Show. Crow TV. Crow.org. You're able to watch it. But I will be back Monday for my Yom Kippur speech. And if you're looking for someone to come teach you the meaning of Yom Kippur, that's not me, find somebody else. If you're looking for somebody to give you a ritualistic aspect of Yom Kippur, I'm not doing that either, so find someone else. But I am delivering a message to Black America. I am delivering a message to the Hebrew Israelite Kingdom of Jerusalem. And I am delivering a message to European Israel and those who feel that Israel should be ran by Europeans. Those are three timely messages that I am giving out. And I am always going to be respectful, and I'm always going to be dignified in what I do and what I speak. But if I step on toes, I'm not apologizing for that because I'm only coming with truth. And I know, here you say, well, brother, you, what do you represent? And I'm going to say this, and I'm going to leave this point alone. You catch it on Monday at 1:30. Central Standard Time. I represent the spirit of freedom. And that supersedes any denomination, any cultural background, or religious affiliation. Freedom for those who need freedom. That's what I embody and that's what I represent and that's what I'm going to be speaking to. So you can take that message or you can let it alone. But it will be delivered. So That being said, again, shop blackroyaltyword.com. Again, I thank all of those who have been, I posted, I'm trying to be more active in this and showing my product. But likes are cool. I appreciate them. But you can buy something too. Support yourself. Because anybody who knows me know what I do is for the people. So again, let's continue to create entities that represent us, that are high quality, that are not overpriced, but also give back. Because I said last week, the resources that we're developed are going into an institution to develop young black men. See, this is what I'm trying to do. This is what I'm trying to create. But it has to be a collective effort. We got to get out of this Superman, messianic, all the work and responsibility on one person. That's not how the world works. That's not how nations are built. Yes, one person may have a particular role, job. Somebody may have something that seems more glorious due to how we've been contextualized by Europeans because they may be in the forefront speaking. But everybody's role and responsibility is needed and must be applied to be a success. Yeah, you see the skin, you see the outward, but everything in the internal is what really what makes the body work. Just because you don't see it, that don't mean it's not functioning. So again, we're going to have to take a collective effort in moving forward. I don't have no 9-to-5. I don't work no job. So if you want me to stay, continue to give in truth and stand up and teach and be an example and be a helper, we got to continue to work with each other. So that we can make that reality come true. See you Monday or tomorrow and next week. So real quickly, we're doing a show. I'm scheduled to be with my father down in Montgomery, Alabama, doing a speech. So I may live stream that, or I may do something early in the week and still live stream that. But we're going to always have content on this Shabbat, irregardless of what's going on. So I just wanted to put that out there as well. So it may not have this setting, but we're still going to come with some power and some strength. I thank you for listening as I leave you, as I greeted you in the words of peace and paradise. Shalom Aleichem. Assalam Aleichem. Peace be unto you.
Logo on my flow mat, Courtside Chamberlain throwback, match my Rolex.